heaven. West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountains, Shenandoah River. Life is old there, older than the trees, younger than the mountains, growing like a breeze. Country roads take me home to the place I belong, West Virginia, Mountain Mama.
Chapter 2.
This is The Trail from Hope, book one in the Trail series, written by L. Reese. When we had first moved here, my father had tried to set up a small farm with the goat or two that he had traded silver coins for. The small fenced-in area of grass near the dirt road in front of the house also held a few chickens that would simply walk around and peck the ground. It was not ideal, but at the time the backyard was overgrown. Dad had slept on the front porch during the warmer months to deter predators with a blast from an old shotgun. In those first couple of weeks, we had lost a couple of chickens, but had hatched many more and even had a young goat. Besides the predators, there had been a couple occasions where a chicken had gone missing, and my father hadn't thought much about it. It was a problem the whole town dealt with. Our eggs were actually so sought after because many other people just couldn't keep their chickens alive. So there were only a few people that had them. The reason? Foxes, bobcats, coyotes. We had lost a goat recently, but that disappearance was pretty unexplainable. The reason for those disappearances were just thieves looking for an easy meal. Father could only watch the pens so much. And the predators seemed to only take the chickens as they could make off with them rather quickly. One afternoon, as I was playing on the porch with my brother, I heard a rumble of an old engine. An old truck came screaming up the dirt road and skidded to a stop in front of our house, on the dirt road about 20 yards away. My dad rushed out and yelled. He walked past my brother and I and went down the steps to the yard as the two teens jumped out of the bed of the truck that stopped in front of our house. Then they jumped the short fence. One grabbed a goat and one a chicken. Both animals made loud calls and pleas to their kidnappers. "What are you little bastards doing?" my dad yelled. The two teens jumped back over the fence with their loot, then shots rang out. The man behind the wheel of the truck was the father of those two boys. The townspeople now referred to him as Bastard Bob, but at the time I am fairly sure it was just Bob. Bob was firing a pistol from the driver's seat through the passenger window as his little bastards jumped in the bed. My dad instantly ran back up to the porch steps and picked my brother and I up and ran clear through the screen door to get us to safety. The next thing I knew as a small child was that Mrs. Belvin's was there, and my dad was gone. At the time, I wasn't sure where he'd gone, but from what some of the people in town said, my dad had found Bob in town trying to sell the goat and gave him a beating. It had been such a spectacle at the time that every once in a while, someone would mention or make a comment to my dad while patting him on the back. After that, our family was looked well upon. Not only was my dad caring, but Bob had been a nuisance in town since he was a kid, and apparently his two sons had not been any better. Now that someone had finally stood up to him, the town had apparently decided to banish the whole family, making the town a better place to live. I only heard of the aftermath about 8 years later during my first visit to the market by myself. My dad was sick with the flu, and we had just gotten back from the mountains with a large buck. He did not want me to go to the market, but I simply waited until he was asleep and loaded up the wagon. As I made my way to the market, I was nervous as I had never been by myself. I had thought about bringing my brother, but he was invested in the book he was reading. I'm fairly sure it was a Swiss Family Robinson. "Haven't you read that book 20 times?" I asked. "We could go on a real adventure." He looked at me for a moment and replied, "I like this fantasy story more than our own." So I rolled my eyes and I pulled the wagon to town by myself. The walk was always nice, but it felt strange doing it by myself. The trip to town was usually a time for all of us to have fun and joke during the walk. Nat stood there on the edge of the market with the cuts of deer meat. Finding an empty booth near the front, she started to lay out the meat. People started to come up and, as usual, were just as friendly as could be. We all knew each other, of course, but it seemed almost everyone in town loved my father, so were always exceptionally nice to us. They were always saying how Dad was the most giving member of the town, and how their town had gotten better from the moment he had gotten here, and hoped for his fast recovery. After a few sales, the table cleared, and Mrs. Thorne caught eye of me from across the way, and grabbed her husband, who had been talking to a couple at the time, and pulled him towards my table. They were a nice enough couple. They had the only pharmacy in town, and I knew that I needed to trade with them badly. My dad was hard up, and I knew they would give me the medicine at a fair price. But my dad had always said some of the people just like a good bit of haggling. Even if the price ended up being the same, the action of negotiating was a tradition, and it could be fun for some. Mrs. Thorne always had on a nice dress and found some way to keep her big poofy hair dark red, even though they were both in their 60s. She always had her Bible clenched against her chest, and always sang the high key in church, it seemed. Mr. Thorne was a short, balding man with a bit of a gut, and he was always kindly and nice. It seemed he was usually being dragged somewhere by his wife, but he was always smiling and would give her a kiss on the cheek every time the two of them got to wherever he was being pulled to. Mrs. Thorne came up, and before I could say hi, she brought me in for a hug. She always did this, so I was ready for it. We had helped them about 2 years earlier when they lost their entire garden to a bushfire. When my dad heard about it, he immediately gone to our garden and loaded the wagon down with everything that could be picked and took it over to him.
"Here, sweetie," Miss Thorne said as she handed me a paper bag. "We heard your dad was not feeling well and this should help. And I don't want to hear anything about payment."
Then she turned and walked away. Mr. Thorne was still standing there, eyeing a piece of venison. I pulled out a piece of paper and grabbed the biggest venison steak I had and wrapped it up.
"Just put it in your pocket and she'll never know," I told him with a smile.
"Thanks, dear," he said as he quickly stuffed it into his coat pocket. "Tell your dad we hope to see him next month." Then he turned and shuffled after his wife. That's how they were. Mrs. Thorne always seemed to be in a bit of a rush, and Mr. Thorne was always trying to catch up, because he would try to at least get in a short conversation. The rest of the day went pretty normal, and by the end I had gotten biscuits, a bottle of moonshine, a dozen bottles of home-brewed beer, a baseball cap, a Zippo lighter, an old military cook set, 2 pairs of old blue jeans, and 2.5 silver dollars, with one literally cut in half. A pretty good day at the market, I thought to myself. I didn't really see a need for the baseball cap, but I thought Nick might like it. It had a white number 3 on it with a red outline. I wasn't sure what Team 3 was, but I figured he might like it anyway. I was about to leave when Mrs. Belvins came up.
"Hi, Nat," she said. "Looks like you did fine today. Filled up your entire wagon. I'm sure your dad would be happy with your take."
I smiled at her whilst maintaining eye contact as I had been taught. "Thank you," I said. Dad wanted to come, but insisted that I come alone as he could get a lot more people sick. Nat kind of laughed to herself, then looked up and saw Mrs. Belvins looking at her with an interesting look. I stopped laughing and apologized. "I'm sorry, Miss Belvins, but even when I was going to hug my dad goodbye earlier today, he put his hand out and told me not to come close. Actually, when we brought the deer down yesterday, he said that I had to dress it myself as he felt a bit of a cold coming on. I wasn't sure if he was telling the truth or just fooling to trick me into doing it myself."
"Your father is a very caring man and smart to stay away," Mrs. Belvins replied.
I looked up at her as she seemed to be staring out in the distance. She seemed to be remembering a memory from the past.
"The pandemics and wars a year ago took a terrible toll," she said as she looked back at me. "Those were bad times and were only made worse by people who cared not even a little for their fellow man."
Nat didn't know what to do, so just shook her head. The woman had always made her uneasy. Mrs. Belvins always had a small smile on her face, but her face never really changed, so you could never try and gauge what she was thinking or how she was feeling. She was tall and thin, with light brown hair, freckles, and eyes that always seemed like there was hurt behind them, like a puppy that had been abused.
She always wore sundresses with bright colors and large hats that looked like they were comfortable. But she never looked comfortable. There had been rumors that she killed her husband.
The official story was that he had drank himself to death, but there had also been rumors that he had been beating her for years. And then one day she just got tired of it and put a pillow over his face when he was passed out drunk. There being no sheriff in the town at the time, he was simply buried and forgotten. After her husband had been placed in the ground, Mrs. Belvin had turned into a kind-seeming woman and spent more time out with the townspeople, but there had always seemed something off about her. Nat had always thought that it could have been because she wasn't used to being out in public, and instead was used to staying away so that people did not see the bruises that her husband gave her. Now, Nat didn't know if any of that was true, but deep down she always tried to be as nice as she could to Mrs. Belvin's, just in case it was true. Nat wanted her to thrive in her new life, even if that made her uncomfortable.
"Well, my father is a good man, and he does care about others,"
Nat said fondly of her father.
"He might be the best man I know.
He might be the best man I know." Mrs. Belvin's chuckled a little, but without her smile really changing.
"Your father is a good man, and the whole town knows it. Now, I don't want to keep you talking all evening, as it's getting dark, so I'll let you go now. Tell your father we're praying for his quick recovery," she said.
But Nat's focus had been drawn by something that caught her eye.
Nat had caught a glimpse of something blue with a little light purple. Her eyes had been drawn to a table with a piece of cloth. With only a few vendors still packing up, Nat saw a piece of cloth on a table across the market blowing a little in the breeze. This is when the vendor, a young man, picked it up and folded it, and Nat saw it in its entirety. It was a summer dress of blue cloth. It was the color of a clear summer sky and dotted with purple flowers that were the color of a salvia plant. It had short, ruffled sleeves and was cinched in the middle, with a light purple belt the same color as the flowers. They were like the color of some of the flowers she would see in their northern pastures. She had always thought them to be beautiful.
"Holy shit," Nat said under her breath. Now, Nat was not one to wear dresses. They had no use when one was hunting, gardening, or traversing the woods. She had not worn a dress for as long as she could remember. It was always a cotton shirt and either khakis or jeans. Those were the clothes worn by someone living off the land, and she had never really seen a dress like this one, or at least one that she wanted. She looked at it as the young man folded it and put it into his car until she felt a light touch on her shoulder. She turned, and it was Mrs. Belvin's.
"Sorry, Nat. Was I boring you?" she asked with that unmoving smile.
"Sorry," Nat answered. "I didn't mean to be rude, of course. It's just that..."
"It's no problem," Mrs. Belvin said. "Besides, I was looking at that dress as well."
I looked back to her, and she was smiling at me.
"Natalie," she said with a pause, "let me buy it for you."
Before I could say anything, she started walking towards the young man.
Nat was unsure of what to do, so she started walking after Mrs. Belvin's and had almost caught up to her when she realized she didn't wagon everything that she had traded for. Her head shot up and pivoted around. She needed that medicine for her father and had been foolishly distracted by Mrs. Belvin's and left it. She'd been taught better by her father. Now, when she turned to see the young boy, who seemingly appeared out of nowhere, was picking up the handle to her wagon. Nat sprinted the short distance and came to a stop just a few feet short of the boy.
"That's mine!"
I almost yelled. The boy dropped the handle to the wagon and looked at the ground.
"Sorry," he said. "I was only bringing it to you when I realized you had forgotten it."
He looked up for a second and our eyes met before he simply ran off. I watched him run down Main Street for a minute. He had on a green, brown camo top and old khaki pants with brown boots. His hair looked like it hadn't been washed in a while, and he looked to be a bit skinny for the clothes that he was wearing. I started to take a step forward before I felt a hand on my shoulder again. It was Mrs. Belvin's.
"I doubt anyone would steal from you, Natalie," she said as she moved to my side and looked to the boy running down the street.
"Especially not that young man." I watched the boy for another few seconds before I looked at her. She looked down at me, and a soothing smile came to her face.
"You see, your father is a hero to some," she started. She looked back down the street to where the boy had been.
After all, she continued, that boy's brother and father were killed by the ruthless man that tried to rule this town with fear. Then she laughed to herself. Hell, that boy would probably follow you and your dad to the ends of the earth for what your dad did to those bastards.
What's his name? Nat asked softly while watching the boy disappear into the distance.
Sean, she answered.
Me and Mrs. Belvin stood there for a couple of seconds before I simply uttered the name.
Bastard Bob?
She was silent at first, but then answered softly.
Yes, Bob was the prime suspect when the two of them went missing for a couple of days. Apparently they had gone down to the river to trade a rooster for a few pieces of silver with Bob.
Mrs. Belvin's looked away again, then took a deep breath before looking back at Nat.
They were found 2 days later, shot, and in the river floating against a log dam about a mile down the river.
Nat took in this information, kind of surprised. She knew the town wasn't perfect, but had never heard about these murders. She shook her head before asking, "Does that Sean have a mother?" Mrs. Belvin shook her head.
"No, his mother died during the end times."
"Well, is he just homeless, then?" Nat asked, concerned. She was ready to run after the boy when Mrs. Belvin continued.
"I watch the boy now. You have probably never seen us together because he does not like people."
Nat shook her head after learning this information. She didn't come to town a lot, but apparently it was a different town than she had thought. Seeming to read Natalie's mind, Mrs. Belvin continued as she looked down the road again.
"He does look homeless, but the truth is he doesn't like the water. And it's hard to make him bathe."
Nat thought about this for a second before realizing that young Sean probably didn't like the way the water was because his father and brother had been found in the river. She wanted to tear up from everything she was learning. But then the young man from the booth with the dress came up holding a brown paper bag.
Sorry to interrupt, but here you are, Mrs. Belvin's.
Sorry to interrupt, but here you are, Mrs. Belvin's.
Thank you, Ron, she said. Now go pack up your cart and head back to my house and have some of the meat pie I left in the kitchen.
Ron nodded nervously and shot a quick glance at Nat and smiled before turning and running back to his cart. Natalie was a little confused as she didn't recognize the young man, and she thought she knew most of the younger people in town. She was about to ask Mrs. Belvin's how she knew the young man when Mrs. Belvin spoke first.
"Come," Mrs. Belvin said. "I'll walk you back home to make sure you get there safely."
She started off when I said, "I could take the woods from here with the wagon and still make it there before you could walk there. I know my way."
"I know," she said. "I know you are your father's daughter and could do anything, but I want to make sure your dad is okay."
She looked back at me and, possibly knowing my argument, said,
"Honestly, I know that he is in the best of hands with you, but I just want to say hi and see him. After all, I'm his friend, and I have not seen him in almost a month. Is that okay, Natalie?"
I was taken aback a little. "Of course that's okay, Mrs. Belvin's. I'll get the wagon and we'll be on our way." We made our way down the dirt road outside of town and mostly stuck to small talk. She asked about our garden and I asked about hers. She apparently grew a lot of flowers, which I thought was dumb, but politely, I asked about them. She had a very expansive garden and talked for a while about it. She knew how to grow crops and apparently was not wanting. I was somewhat intrigued. I wanted to ask how she knew Sean and the young man from the market. It seemed strange that she knew both young men and how she had told the young man at the market to go back to her house. I was intrigued, but I thought it might be rude to ask since she didn't offer an explanation. Then before I knew it, we were in front of my house. She simply looked at the fence surrounding our small goat flock, then to the chickens roaming around, then to the house. My father had spent a lot of time refurbishing the farmhouse that we had pretty much stolen because it was just sitting there abandoned. "Well, thank you, Mrs. Belvin's. I enjoyed your company," Nat said. Mrs. Belvin's just stood there looking at the house for a few seconds, so Nat just nodded her head and turned to walk up the driveway. After a few steps, Mrs. Belvin's asked,
"Do you want to know what your dad did to Bob Watkins after he shot at you all that day?"
Nat stopped and turned to look at Mrs. Belvin's. The woman stood there looking at Nat with a face that didn't really say anything. Nat was intrigued. She took a few steps closer to the woman.
"I would, actually. My dad has refused to tell me the story, yet for most of my life I've heard people tell the story in hushed tones until I get close. And some still thank my dad for it. Most people say my father did a hell of a thing for the town, yet I still don't know what the hell happened. People still give thanks to him with a word or a nod, and when I'm with him, the people always look at us and then back to my father before simply saying, "Thank you," before walking away. Nat let out an exaggerated sigh and continued. My father is looked highly upon in this town, and it seems to stem from that one thing, and yet he refuses to tell me the story. Nat's face showed the frustration that she had always felt after asking her dad what happened. He was a highly respected and loved member of the community, but seemed to refuse his daughter, even now, the story of what he had done. "I have heard that my father beat Bob," Natalie said in frustration. "I also know that the entire town was scared of Bob until my father beat him." Nat paced a little in the dirt driveway, kicking up a little dust and drawing attention from the goats and chickens, who now moved closer to the fence to catch a show, it seemed. Nat was frustrated a little that the whole town seemed to know what happened, and yet she did not. She was not frustrated at her dad because he would not tell her, but thought that she should know. It had been 10 or more years since the incident, and she was not a child anymore. She was an adult. Obviously, she didn't see the townspeople that often, but she had figured someone would have to tell her by now. Though she had never asked, she usually was with her father, and the people of the town seemed to have an agreement with John not to talk about it when the kids were around. Maybe it had been a good thing that she had gone to town by herself that day. Nat stopped pacing and took a deep breath. Then she took another. She felt that she deserved to know. "I know that my dad beat Bob," Nat said in a firm voice. "I know that he did a great thing for this town, and I know that he is a hero to this town," she continued as she took a few steps towards Mrs. Belvin's. Mrs. Belvin stayed still and gave that smile that wasn't a smile for a moment as she looked at Nat. Then she looked down at the ground. Natalie thought maybe she just didn't want to speak about it, and that was fine. But she had hoped she would finally learn why her father was such a hero. "I'm sorry, Mrs. Belvin's," Nat said as she turned around and started to walk back towards the wagon.
"Do you really want to know what your father did that day so many years ago?" Mrs. Belvin said in a low voice.
Natalie slowly turned and looked the woman in her eyes. Except this was not the same woman. This was not the woman who had a happy expression plastered on her face at all times. Mrs. Belvin's now had a sincere look of concern on her face. She wasn't frowning, but it was a true look of concern. And her eyes narrowed as she really looked at Nat. With a shake of her head, Nat whispered, "Yes."
"Well, dear,"
Mrs. Belvin said as her little smile returned, and she walked up to Nat and put her arm around her shoulder. The woman then looked at the house, and then walked the two of them back down the road towards where they came from until the house was no longer in view. Once they couldn't be seen, she took her arm from Nat's shoulder and stood in front of her. The pair stared into each other's eyes for what had been a full minute. Being this close to actually finding out the truth, Nat was going to wait.
"It was probably 2 weeks after Bob had shot at you three."
Mrs. Belvin looked down to the ground, then down the road, and then back at Nat. She seemed to be trying to remember the actual scene, or at least what she had witnessed those years ago, as to give the most accurate account of events that she could.
"Bob used to leave town, passing right by your house here," she said as she pointed over at the driveway. "His wife had been a smart woman, but never appreciated. And she died giving birth to the second. He used to drive the old roads after the inn and try to shoot or run over a deer, because it was easier than going into the mountains, I guess. I was never with him. I just heard so from others before your family even got here. That was just a thing that he did, so I do not know for sure. But in the weeks preceding the incident, Bob had been heard around town talking about your father and how he had more than he needed, and how your father should share with those that were in need, and how your family were a bunch of outsiders come to steal from everyone in town."
"It was nonsense, really," Mrs. Belvin said with an exaggerated swipe of her hand.
"From the start, your father was a good man and would help anyone that needed help. Bob, I'm guessing, was just jealous or worried that someone strong like your father might actually put him in his place and keep him from preying on the weak. He was always a blight on our small community. His family had always been, actually. Now, I won't get into the details about his father, but Bob was actually a step up from him. Anyway,"
Mrs. Belvin said as she flicked her hand in an attempt to stop from going off on a tangent and stick to the story that she was trying to tell.
People like Bob will always be losers and will always blame those who are better than him in every way of being the reason he is a loser. Our great country suffered right after the end because of people like Bob. He always seemed to play the victim, even though his situation was always his own and no one else's. He was of small mind and could not accept that he was a loser, so he looked to blame others. And your father was a prime target. Through the grapevine, people of the town had learned of Bob and his sons shooting at you, your brother, and your father. Bob had actually bragged about it and thought the people would rally behind him. He was one of the town citizens and thought that he could use that fact to spread hate and fear against your family. But he was not a smart man and apparently missed the time after the end when people promised to not let fear-mongering affect them like it had in the past. People were not happy, she said as she shook her head. People were not happy at all. And some of the townspeople let Bob know that. It didn't do much, though. People expressing their dislike for Bob and his family usually meant that Bob would try and fight whomever gave him a cross look or would pull his pistol on unsuspecting folk while the boys laughed. Hell, sometimes the little bastard sons would attack people, she said with a defeated laugh and another shake of her head. Then she took a deep breath and continued. For 2 weeks, Bob had been in and out of town and would say things about your father that I dare not repeat. Then one day, Bob came into the town for the farmer's market with his two sons. It seemed that the mention of that day made Mrs. Belvins happy, because a smile spread across her face. And not the fake smile she usually showed, but a genuine smile of happiness. Unfortunately for Bob, though, John was in the market that day. Everyone in the entire town saw him coming down the road with that very wagon, she said as she pointed at the wagon that was back in the driveway. She threw her arms up with emphasis. Everyone in town saw John coming into the farmer's market that day, except for Bob. Bob was trying to peddle something, I don't remember, she said as she put her hand to her forehead, as if trying to remember what it was. After a minute, she looked up, then over at the goats. Then, with realization, she drew her hands to her chest, and clasped together, she almost shouted, A goat! Yes, it was a goat that he had stolen from your father. He brought it in right before your father showed up, and he didn't even see John approach while he was trying to sell it. But as soon as your father saw Bob... Mrs. Belvins held her hands out to Nat like she was trying to hug her, but her eyes were looking somewhere else, somewhere into the past. The instant John saw Bob, he dropped the handle of that little wagon laid heavy with deer meat. Then he got a stern and determined look on his face and started to walk.
A little giggle escaped Mrs. Belvin's mouth as she was apparently seeing the past right in front of her. Nat just stood there and listened.
Oh, and your dad had a determined walk that day,
she said as she came back to the present and looked at Nat.
Your dad had a determined walk, and the entire town actually stopped and watched him. Bob was not the sharpest tool in the shed, but you'd think the man would realize when the entire town went quiet.
She paused.
But he didn't. When John was a few paces from Bob, his bastard son saw him. They had been doing something nearby, and when they saw your father, they called out to theirs. Oh, Lord!
Mrs. Belvins yelled on the side of the road as if it was actually happening.
Bob spun around so fast and went for his gun. He didn't know what was happening, but his boys had called out for him to watch out, so Bob was ready to kill.
Mrs. Belvins bent down dramatically, and Nat was wondering now if she was a little crazy. Sure, someone could tell an animated story, but she was wondering if the woman in front of her might be a little insane. Finally, the woman slowly stood erect and continued as she once again stared off into nothing.
Well,
she started in a hushed tone.
John grabbed the barrel of Bob's gun and jerked it skyward. He was able to fire a shot, but the end for him had already begun. With a swift knee, John caught him in the genitals and Bob went down. His two boys had pistols and started to draw them, but damn, no one is a match against your father.
Mrs. Belvin said it in a way that made Nat uncomfortable, before she continued.
He had stripped Bob of his pistol and then fired twice at the boys.
Nat was looking off trying to imagine the scene, and listening to the story when she realized Mrs. Belvin's had gone silent. She looked back and the woman was looking at her.
Now I do not condone violence,
she said as she wagged her finger at Nat. Then she smiled again.
But damn, your dad let out 2 shots and dropped those 2 bastards.
What happened next? Nat asked. She was a little excited to hear about the heroics of her father. She already knew he was a strong and capable man, but just hearing a story that she had always wanted to hear made her want to know what happened next. She had wanted to hear this story for years and was getting more excited about it the more she heard.
Well, Mrs. Belvins continued, John walked over to those 2 boys, took their guns away, and gave a quick boot to both of them. Cowards as they were used to giving the hurt but not taking it. They both grabbed their heads and started to writhe and cry right there on the ground. John, though, walked quickly back over to Bob. He stood over him and tossed the 3 pistols that he had taken on the table. Then he went to work on Bob.
Mrs. Belvins then put her right hand on her hips, and it seemed she tried to stifle a cry of joy for a second. Then she seemed to compose herself and looked back at Nat.
Oh dear, it was brutal yet satisfying to see.
She continued,
your father kicked and punched and slapped Bob silly. Every once in a while he would go back to his sons and give him a boot before he moved back to Bob.
Nat heard this and was a little put off.
That sounds awful, Nat cut in. My father is a good man. I know that he was a soldier before, but to beat defenseless people like that, it just doesn't seem like him.
At this, Mrs. Belvin stood up straight and looked at Nat with a hard look. She seemed to almost be mad at her. It was an expression Natalie had not thought possible from the woman. But then the look started to soften.
Oh, dear child. Bob and his sons were not only nasty, terrible people, but 2 weeks before this, they had shot at you and your brother. I'm sure you don't remember that, but do not think better of those men. The whole town watched your father beat them with happiness in their hearts.
Nat looked down to the ground. I just, she started. It just seems weird to me that my father would do those things. Mrs. Belvins reached her hand out and lifted her chin.
Your father is a great man, and he made it apparent that day by not killing those 3. The entire time he beat them, he said not one word. Finally, when he was exhausted and his knuckles were bloodied and his feet sore, he stopped. He stood over Bob and uttered just 1 sentence.
Nat wanted to know what her father had said, but now Mrs. Belvin's eyes were closed. Then a tear streamed down her face. Nat put her hand on the woman's shoulder. She opened her eyes and they were wet, but she was smiling. A true smile.
What did my dad say?
Nat asked. The older woman's face pursed and she bit her lip.
He said, you have put myself and my children in danger recently. But you have been a sore on this small town for far too long, Bob. It's time that the 3 of you leave forever and never come back.
Nat was astonished. What happened after that? She asked in a small voice. Mrs. Belvin's gasped, trying to hold back tears. But she had a smile on her face.
Well, your father is a good man after all. So we patched up the boy's gunshot wounds, which were only flesh wounds. Got some of the men to pick Bob and his sons up. Gathered food for them from those in the market and had a farmer and some other men drive them down this road and about 8 hours away left them. He made sure they had food and water and a few medical supplies so they would not perish, but let Bob know that if he ever come back, him and his sons would swing from a rope.
Nat turned and walked back to her wagon. She was both happy and a little distraught. She had heard whispers of what he had done, but after hearing it for the first time, she had more questions about the goings-on that she was not told. She pulled the wagon up the driveway a little until she stopped. She wanted to know more. She looked back to ask more questions, but Mrs. Belvins was gone. Her father was a good man, she thought. But he could also be dangerous. That story made her appreciate her father more, and now she understood why the people of the town loved him so much. She had always heard the thanks her father had gotten over the years and witnessed the extreme kindness of everyone in town. He had seemed to fight to give people a fair price in the market, even when everyone tried to overpay him. Nat had never caught on why. But on their walks back home, she had asked him many times why people seemed to try and give him more for meats and pelts. But he had always shrugged it off and said that he had done something years ago that people appreciated and had since tried to repay him. He had never said what he had done, but always insisted that it was because he had righted a wrong.
and that he had stood up for people that could not stand up for themselves. That's when Nat realized who her father was. He was a good man who sometimes had to do bad things to protect those who could not protect themselves.
All my memories gather round her. Mine is lady, stranger to blue water. Dark and dusty, painted on the sky. Misty taste of moonshine, teardrop in my eye. Country road.